Thank you. I would ask those members who are leaving the chamber to please do so quickly and quietly. And the final item of business is the members' business debate. And could I ask those members who are actually leaving the chamber to please now do so quickly and quietly? Thank you very much, because we're actually in session. The final item of business is the members' business debate on motion 11664 in the name of Colette Stevenson on protecting FCDO jobs in East Kilbride. This debate will be concluded without any questions being put, and I would ask those members who would wish to speak in the debate to please press the request to speak buttons, and I call on Colette Stevenson to open the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Ms Stevenson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm grateful to have the opportunity to lead this debate on the need to protect civil service jobs in East Kilbride. The Foreign, Commonwealth and Development Office, or FCDO, has had a presence at Abercrombie House for over four decades. Currently, there are around 1,000 people working there, and this has increased in recent years, and I very much welcome that. However, a few weeks ago, the Tory government announced that the FCDO would be leaving Abercrombie House. This is a hammer blow to East Kilbride, and it could, according to the UK government's own figures, cost the town's economy £30 million. So I'm grateful to SNP, Greens and Labour colleagues for supporting my motion. It's sad that no members of the Conservative Party have done so, including those who live in and represent East Kilbride. I have raised this matter in the chamber before, and the Tories tried to diminish it. What I am doing, Presiding Officer, is standing up for East Kilbride in the face of Tory plans to remove 1,000 jobs from my constituency. Let me set out the context. Firstly, the UK Government's Declaration on Government Reform commits to relocating jobs and areas of activity across government to places including East Kilbride. So the Tories are even breaking their own policy commitments. After the announcement of the closure of the FCDO base at Abercrombie House, many people, including Tory politicians, said it's no big deal since HMRC will be moving in. But HMRC has been based in East Kilbride for decades. These are not new jobs for the town, and staff at HMRC have faced their own challenges with the Tories. In 2014, the UK government announced that HMRC would be leaving East Kilbride and other towns across Scotland to move into regional centres. This led, quite rightly, to a huge backlash. Indeed, Conservative MSP Graham Simpson called this move misguided. The PCS trade union launched its Stay in East Kilbride campaign, backed by East Kilbride News and local politicians on a cross-party basis. Following this hard-fought campaign, we managed to keep HMRC in the town, so it beggars belief that the UK government will instead cut 1,000 jobs from East Kilbride by removing FCDO. After its U-turn, HMRC recognised that keeping a presence in East Kilbride made the best sense. And I hope that today's debate, as well as all the concerns from staff, which I'll come on to next, will help the FCDO see sense too. A big issue with the UK government's announcement was the lack of respect shown to the workforce. I understand that there was no prior consultation with staff about the potential move, and reports suggest that trade unions were given just 1 hour's notice about the announcement. Local staff are upset about the decision, with one employee telling the press that you could not get any lower morale than there is at Abercrombie House just now, and saying that people are at rock bottom. I have spoken with FCDO staff who are worried about their future, and I have heard stories of people who have left jobs in Glasgow to work closer to home, and some who have even moved from HMRC given the threats of it moving out of the town. The UK government should have given the experiences of their staff some thought before seemingly rushing into this decision. Civil servants weren't the only ones caught off guard with the announcement, though. My understanding is that the FCDO has been in discussions with South Lanarkshire Council about a new site in the town. So the decision to abandon East Kilbride altogether left the council astounded. The whole thing seems to be ill thought through. The HMRC saga showed that politicians of different parties can and must work together when it comes to standing up for the areas that they represent. I've had productive conversations with the Labour leader of South Lanarkshire Council, Joe Fagan, and Labour MSPs Monica Lennon and Mark Griffin supported my motion. Conservative politicians, on the other hand, seem to have lost their voice. After the department, headed by the unelected Lord David Cameron, made its decision, I wrote to Graham Simpson MSP and the other unelected Tory, Lisa Cameron MP, to ask if they stood by their previous remarks that FCDO must stay in East Kilbride. I also wrote to Alistair Jack, Secretary of State for Scotland, seeking assurances. I've received nothing back from any of them. I hope that Tory politicians have been able to reflect over the Christmas break. They must recognise the concerns, not just from me, not just from the council, but from the local staff who carry out the government's work. To sum up, Presiding Officer, the Tory UK government's plans to close down the Foreign Commonwealth and Development Office in East Kilbride is a betrayal of the town. This has already caused unnecessary stress for many employees, and it could lead to millions of pounds of damage to the East Kilbride economy. With this debate, I hope to bring more attention to this reckless decision and to give a voice to the staff who feel as if they have been overlooked in this process. The UK government must engage meaningfully with the workforce, trade unions and all interested local representatives. They must ensure an impact assessment is carried out in terms of the workforce and of the potential harm to East Kilbride's economy. In my view, Presiding Officer, the UK government must scrap these plans immediately and avoid a further broken promise to the people of East Kilbride. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Stevenson. I now call Ben McPherson to be followed by Graham Simpson. Mr McPherson.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I pay tribute to my colleague, Colette Stevenson, for bringing this important motion. And as she has set out, the detrimental impacts of these proposals on her constituency would clearly be significant, and we all support her in her efforts and the wider efforts from trade unions and others to get the UK government to reconsider this decision. The reason I wanted to speak today, however, was to emphasise something more, which is the wider beneficial impact that the workers in the East Kilbride, the civil servants, the diligent, capable, focused, highly motivated people in that office have made, not just in terms of Scotland's reputation as a good global citizen, not just in terms of diplomacy and building a more internationalist world and outlook, but also the lives that have been saved, the people that have been helped, and the significant contribution that's been made to supporting highly well thought of international organisations, whether that's the United Nations or the World Food Programme or others. And that's because the office in question today, when it was previously highly occupied by DFID staff members, as well as its current status as FCDO, has played a huge role in the last quarter of a century in making a global difference. for example, leading the world in tackling the Ebola crisis, and in recent years, in the last decade, providing aid to the people of Syria and responding to other humanitarian crises elsewhere. The decision in 2020 by the current UK government to end the Department for International Development was a mistake, and I fear that there's another mistake being made here, because as colleagues will know, I served as a Scottish Government Minister between 2018 and last year, 2023. Between 2018 and 2020, I had the great privilege of being responsible for Europe migration and international development. And I can say that the number of staff that I met, not just within the Scottish Government, but within other organisations who'd began their careers in East Kilbride, was a high amount, and indeed when I worked in other roles in other departments, civil servants had begun their careers in East Kilbride. So that shows the impact, both in terms of the direct work that comes out of Abercrombie House and the impact that that makes on an international scale, but also in terms of the quality of civil servants and the beginning of civil servants' careers, as well as all those who've worked at the office for some time, the impact that they make when they go on elsewhere in the civil service. East Kilbride is a strategically important workplace, and that workplace will have a network within itself, it will have a culture, and all of that would be detrimentally affected by dissipating and relocating the workforce. So this office, this place, is important for East Kilbride. It's important for Scotland more widely. It's important for our civil service. And it's important for the impact that it's made internationally. And I think it's important that we all and that other politicians consider those wider effects, as well as the mistake that would be made in terms of negatively impacting the people of East Kilbride if this decision is not reversed and this mistake by the UK Government is seen to happen. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms McPherson. I now call Graeme Simpson to be followed by Monica Lennon. Mr Simpson.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. I will start by congratulating Colette Stevenson for securing this debate. Now, she's mentioned me a few times, and I'll come on to that. But I was speaking at a school visited the Parliament earlier, and I was telling the pupils how I first got involved in politics when I was at school a long time ago. And while I was at school, in 1980, a report came out. It was the Brandt Report, headed by Willy Brandt, and that was all about international development, and we learned about the North-South divide. And the message in that report was how it's important for developed nations to help less developed nations, and that would benefit us all. And I read that report, all of it. I supported that message, and my views have not changed since. I've been a supporter of international development for over 40 years. So I've always felt a sense of pride that the UK's international development programme was being delivered from the town that I've represented as a councillor and MSP since 2007. If I have a frustration, it is that DFID and now the Foreign and Commonwealth and Development Office reaches out to the world but does not reach out to its Scottish home very well. It hasn't really, to my mind, sold what a great story that it has very well. Now, in 2015, I think it was 2015, not 2014, the HMRC threatened to leave East Kilbride and go to Glasgow. So a similar situation. As we've heard earlier, there was a campaign launched. It was called Stay in EK. I got involved in that. All parties got involved in that. We worked with the trade unions. I've not heard from the trade unions yet on this one. But that decision, I don't know whether it was a result of that campaign or something else, but it was reversed in January 2022. And of course, anyone who represents the town must have been delighted by that, as I was. So the announcement by the FCDO at the end of last year that they were going to move out of Abercrombie House and go to Glasgow came as a shock. It certainly did come as a shock to me. And I can't stand here and say I was delighted about that. Of course I'm not delighted. I would rather they stay in East Kilbride. It's a result of the lease ending on the current HMRC building at Queensway House. That lease is ending. HMRC... yes, I certainly will. Monica. If a provider get more time...
Yes, that's OK.
Thank you.
Monica Lennon.
Full to Graeme Simpson, and I've been waiting all day to hear that story at the start, because we did the same school chat this morning. He did promise there would be a story. But I would say to Graeme Simpson that the PCS union that he refers to did comment in December that their members were given just an hour's notice of the decision before announced on 7th of December. It's been the Christmas period. People have had time off work, including trade union officials, so we might hear more this week. Does he recognise that giving an hour's notice for a plan that really isn't a plan, because there's no named location in Glasgow for the move, so does he not recognise that is a really ropey plan? And rather than have a go at trade unions for not saying more, we should be putting this back to the UK Tory government for them to give a proper coherent explanation.
And I will be able to give Mr Simpson a good minute back for that lengthy
intervention. I'm grateful for the intervention. The point I was merely making is I've not heard from the PCS. And we did hear from the PCS during the campaign to get HMRC to stay in East Kilbride. So there may be good reasons why they've not been in touch. But, you know, I would encourage them to get in touch with everyone. That's what they should be doing. Now... Yes, I will.
Well, it would have to be much briefer than the previous intervention. Ms Adamson.
I'll try, Presiding Officer. Can I congratulate my colleague Colette on her passion for her constituency and for the jobs there, shared by her predecessor, Linda Fabiani. But I was also a regional MSP at that time, and I was involved with the PCS union and met with them about those closures. But Mr Simpson, do you not recognise that that was round about 2014? These jobs... Both HMRC and the DFID jobs at that time were held up as a jewel in the crown of why we should be staying in the union and a benefit of the union. And it would be a tragedy if they became added to the long list of promises broken at the time of the referendum.
Mr. Graeme Simpson.
Well, that's an unfortunate intervention from Claire Adamson, because she shows precious little knowledge of what's actually going on here, because there are no job losses suggested. In fact, there are going to be more jobs. And the plan is not to get rid of jobs, merely to move the jobs to Glasgow. Now, you know, we can say... So Claire Adamson seemed to be unaware of that. Now, the only... Yeah, no, I'm not going to take any more interventions, unless I get loads more time.
Mr Simpson, I appreciate the member has been generous, but I think we're now at 5 minutes and 6 minutes, so I'll give you an extra minute and a half, but I think we need to respect the time.
You're being extremely generous. The only contact from within the constituency that I've had, unfortunately, is the letter previously referred to from Colette Stevenson, which... was frankly a stunt. And I don't respond to stunts. If Colette Stevenson, and I'm hearing lots of muttering from Mr Stewart, actually.
Please don't.
If Colette Stevenson at any point wants to know what I think about anything, all she needs to do is pop along to my office, which is on the same corridor as she is in. I don't respond to stunts like that, which is why I've not responded to her letter. She could have just come and spoken to me, as she has done on many other occasions. Fortunately, I have spoken to the town's Conservative MP, Lisa Cameron, who has not indulged in such antics, and we have both been in discussions. Well, I don't know. You know, members should do me the courtesy of listening
Yes, members, could we please allow the member who has the floor, Mr Simpson, to conclude his remarks?
Thank you very much. Now, we've both been in discussions with the FCDO. I have spoken personally to the Minister, Andrew Mitchell. We will work, and I'm quite happy to work with Colette Stevenson if she wants to do it properly, and we will work to do all we can to see if there's anything that can be done for staff locally. The key thing here is that staff, if they are to move, have to be treated properly. I've been involved in an office move myself. There are issues like, you know, parking, extra costs for transport, childcare.
Mr. Simpson, can you work from home? Could you please bring your remarks to a close?
But at the end of the day, more people are going to be employed, but we have to work with the staff, and that's why I encourage them to get in touch. If they want to, get in touch with myself. I'd be delighted to hear from them. I think there's more to go on this. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr Simpson. I now call Monica Lennon to be followed by Gillian Mackay. Ms Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and Happy New Year to you and colleagues in the Chamber, and like others, grateful to Colette Stevenson for securing this debate. And it does feel like a debate, so I'm grateful to Graeme Simpson for taking some interventions. I won't repeat some of the things that have been said, because I think Ben McPherson, his thoughtful remarks, has paid tribute to the workforce, you know, over many decades, and made us realise that, yes, there are local impacts and local factors, but also there's a big global dimension to this, and we should remember the important internationalist values in work. And I will remind colleagues that I am a member of the PCS Scottish Parliament group, so that's on my voluntary register of interest. I think, you know, many of us recognise that there are important stakeholders, including the trade unions, but don't wait to be approached, Mr Simpson. You know, you can pick up the phone to workers as well. But I'm here tonight because I am a Central Scotland MSP, so I do represent East Kilbride. I live next door in Blantyre. And, you know, this is a big deal for us locally, and it is a real pity that we don't have unity. We don't have all the elected members locally. I suspect that Graeme Simpson probably does feel this one, and would rather we were in a different situation, but we find ourselves in an election year, and perhaps people feel they can't say what they really think. But people are concerned about the UK Tory government's announcement to close the Foreign, Commonwealth and International Development offices at Abercrombie House, and to move these highly regarded civil service jobs out of East Kilbride. And that's the key thing that I want to focus on tonight, because it is a hard pill to swallow. The UK Tory government did promise more FCDO jobs in East Kilbride, but instead they're moving them out of the town at a time when the council and others are working really hard to think about the future of East Kilbride, its regeneration, and to give people hope and confidence. As we've heard, Abercrombie House was first established in 1981, which happens to be the year that I was born. And at that time, the expansion of the Overseas Development Administration, it did provide a massive boost to the area, giving East Kilbride residents access to stable and secure employment at a time when communities across the Central Belt were suffering due to deindustrialisation and Thatcherism. Before his days playing for the Scotland football team, Alan McCoist worked at Abercrombie House part-time while playing for St Johnstone FC as one of the first 350 employees back then at the start of the 80s. And in his words, he said it was a massive boost for East Kilbride when that building opened. Abercrombie House is a central feature of EK's economic and social life. Since he has been mentioned, I'll mention him again. Councillor Joe Fagan, who is the leader of South Lancashire Council, has said, quote, "I am frankly astounded by the announcement on the FCDO, both the decision itself and the way it has been made. These staff have been working and in many cases living in East Kilbride for decades and are important contributors to our local community and economy. The FCDO announcement has been made out of the blue, suggesting not just a failure of communication, but also a lack of coherence in the decision-making process. The reasons given for the decision are also weak, to say the least, end quote. I know there are some people who work there who perhaps live in Glasgow and feel actually this might not be too big a deal, too much of a move. But for others who live beyond East Kilbride in Strathaven, for example, or in Stonehouse, they are worried about the commute, people with caring responsibilities. There are so many unknowns. And again, that you know, 1 hour's notice before this went public, just before Christmas, it really doesn't sit easy with me. So a few of these points have been made already, but I would just say, as we do come to the close here, that there is time to unite and to put East Kilbride first, to put these jobs first, and to go back with questions to the Secretary of State for Scotland and other UK ministers who've got a plan that doesn't really add up. There is still time for Mr Simpson and for Lisa Cameron to get behind the community and to get behind the workers, because if we can speak with one voice, that will be much stronger. So I'll bring my speech to a close, and I thank all colleagues for their support and Colette Stevenson for bringing it to the Chamber. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms Lennon. And I now call Gillian Mackay.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'd like to thank Colette Stevenson for bringing forward this debate on the relocation of the FCDO office out of East Kilbride. The decision made abruptly by the UK Government has far-reaching consequences for FCDO workers, their families and, as we've already heard, the wider community in East Kilbride. Abercrombie House employs upwards of 1,000 staff members and is estimated to generate £30 million to the local economy. Its contribution to the social and economic fabric of the town, I don't think we can understate. The decision, made with no prior consultation, is deeply concerning, and the dedicated workers at Abercrombie House have been instrumental to the constituency. And this relocation not only impacts the hard-working staff, but also creates a massive shortfall for local services, stores and the business community, triggering a chain reaction that adversely affects East Kilbride as a whole. East Kilbride was once touted as an example of UK government investments outside large cities. This decision starkly contradicts the commitments made by both the Foreign Secretary and the Cabinet Secretary of Levelling Up as recently as 2021. The reasoning provided for the move, I believe, is weak and ill-founded. Mr Simpson said earlier that there would be no job losses in the FCDO, but I believe that that misses the key point, that these are jobs lost to East Kilbride. This decision is not a mere bureaucratic shift for those working at Abercrombie House. People's livelihoods are neither expendable or easily transferable. The relocation of this office forces workers to deal with the choice of working further from home, changing their job, or in the most extreme circumstances, potentially having to give up their job. Not all workers have access to a car, and moving to and from where they live by car or by train represents another cost to workers during a cost of living crisis. Potentially extra childcare costs, longer travel and therefore longer working days. For those who work flexibly due to caring responsibilities, disability or other personal circumstances, now have a real dilemma. Shifting these jobs outside of East Kilbride unfairly burdens workers, and it's disrespectful to them to assume that these dedicated workers can seamlessly transition to an office in Glasgow. A worker wishing to remain anonymous is quoted as saying, "It's going to take 40 minutes each way into town and back, which adds to your working day. There will be childcare costs involved in that. There will be train and bus fares. Although the FCDO say they will cover them for 3 years, that's not good enough, and nobody wants to move." Levelling Up has been touted as a pivotal element in the UK Government's pledge to reduce regional disparities and promote local economies. The closure of the FCDO office in East Kilbride directly contradicts these commitments. It sends an alarming message about the UK Government's dedication to regional development and calls into question the promises it has made to Scotland until very recently. The same UK Government that claimed to be investing over £2.4 billion in Scotland to empower local communities, drive innovation and enhance economic opportunities is now undermining its own commitment to addressing geographic inequalities. Moving valuable jobs away from communities, particularly at the expense of the people of East Kilbride, contradicts the very principles the government say they support. It raises questions about the sincerity of its efforts to promote opportunities in all regions. It's as recently as 2021 that the UK Government made a commitment to send an additional 500 workers to the facility, and now we have this decision instead. We should join together and strongly advocate for the preservation of the jobs, expertise and valuable contributions made by the workers at Abercrombie House. I reiterate my disappointment and frustration with the UK Government's abrupt decision to relocate the FCDO office out of East Kilbride. The repercussions are keenly felt within the community and cast doubts on the UK Government's commitments to levelling up. I urge the UK Government to reconsider and reverse this ill-advised decision, emphasising the need for a renewed commitment to the workers of Abercrombie House and East Kilbride.
Thank you, Ms Mackay. And I now call on Minister Richard Lockhead to respond to the debate. Around 7 minutes, please, Minister.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. And firstly, can I pay tribute to all the members who have made powerful contributions to this debate today, and of course, in particular, to Colette Stevenson, the member for East Kilbride. And no one can fail to be impressed by her passionate advocacy for her constituents in East Kilbride and the strength of feeling that she's expressed over this issue that she's brought to the Chamber today. And of course, the strength of feeling was also clear from many other members that spoke in the debate as well. I should perhaps just say at the beginning of my remarks that I was raised in Clarkston, neighbouring community to East Kilbride, and I remember as a youngster finding it quite unusual but also refreshing that there was hundreds of jobs just up the road working on international development on behalf of the UK government. Of course, this was prior to devolution as well. So I'm aware of the presence of those jobs and the impact they've had on East Kilbride over many decades, and I remember that well from where I was growing up. As others have said, just to look at the history of the jobs there in the UK government's department, on Monday the 23rd of November 1981, Lord Carrington, the then Foreign Secretary, officially opened Abercrombie House in East Kilbride. So it began life with around 350 staff, and at the time it was built as part of an expansion of the Overseas Development Administration, which was part of the Foreign Office, to create jobs in East Kilbride. And it went on to be the joint headquarters of the Department for International Development, known as DFID, before the merger of the FCO and DFID. So more recently, in November 2021, the FCDO warmly celebrated the 40th anniversary of Abercrombie House, and the UK government used that opportunity to reaffirm and cement the relationship with its staff and with East Kilbride. Indeed, the Foreign Secretary at the time, herself, Liz Truss, is quoted as saying that our 1,000 staff in Scotland can proudly celebrate 40 years of Abercrombie House, having been at the forefront of making the UK a world-leading diplomatic and development superpower. Ms Truss went on to reinforce that and said, and I quote, she was looking forward to building on Abercrombie House's impressive history, giving a bold commitment to, and I quote again, redeploy a further 500 jobs to the joint HQ by 2025. She stated this was part of the UK government's levelling up agenda. So that is why myself and fellow ministers fully understand and support the dedicated civil service staff at Abercrombie House today, and accept and appreciate why they are so perplexed by the announcement. Only 2 years later, from what I was stating earlier on in terms of those quotes, the UK government have reneged on that commitment to the staff and the town, reversing that decision to build on their impressive history and moving all of their jobs and the entire department now out of Abercrombie House, according to the plans, and out of East Kilbride. As many members have echoed, towns are much more than simply buildings and spaces. They represent our communities, and for many civil servants, Abercrombie House is the beating heart of that community of East Kilbride. Also, on learning about the 40th anniversary celebrations, as Monica Lennon did, I also noted that a famous son of East Kilbride was one of the very first employees of Abercrombie House, and of course that is Scotland's former footballer and now commentator Ali McCoist. And at the 40th anniversary, he paid tribute by saying, and I quote, "It's amazing to think that 26 of the people I worked with then when Abercrombie House first opened are still there." And he noted that that was a massive boost for East Kilbride at the time, and that he still remembered his first day and how proud his parents were that he got the ODA job. To quote him, Of course, he's not wrong. It is an embedded and important part of the fabric of the town of East Kilbride and presents high-quality employment opportunities for local people, as many members have said, as well as having a very significant positive impact for local businesses and the economy, again, as others have said. And, of course, there is that point that the FCDO themselves stated, that again has been made, that it generates an estimated £30 million per annum for the local economy in East Kilbride and the wider region. But again, this is not just about numbers or roles or just simply locations, it's about people. And today we are all thinking about those who have been dedicating their working lives to the delivery of mainly overseas development assistance to those around the world in greatest need, directly from East Kilbride for the last four decades. And Ben McPherson eloquently paid tribute to the work carried out there, helping people around the world, as Monica Lennon and Gillian Mackay did, in terms of the contribution of the staff who work there and their wider work that they carry out. So the town can be rightly proud of its role and the impact in the lives of some of the world's poorest and most marginal people. And of course, as a government, we place a great deal of importance on Scotland being a good global citizen and central to our own commitment to raising Scotland's international profile, and providing that assistance is our International Development Fund, which supports and empowers our partners in Malawi, Rwanda, Zambia and Pakistan to the tune of £15 million per annum. So the staff there do certainly carry out vital work, and I very much fully sympathise with those affected by the unexpected news. The decision made by the UK Government to relocate the Foreign, Commonwealth and Development Office to a new location in Glasgow was not a decision that the Scottish Government was aware of. As governments, I think it's important to say we should be working with our colleagues and trade unions to reach fair and reasonable decisions which respect the legitimate interests of workers. Of course, at times that may mean difficult decisions as well, but the principle of no surprises is an important one. And given the level of surprise and subsequent discontent in the news, I would join others in the Chamber today, as the Scottish Government would do more widely, to urge the UK Government to follow the Scottish Government's more progressive approach and engage fully in meaningful conversation with both the staff affected as well as the local community. In the meantime, and as I conclude my remarks, the Scottish Government continues to support East Kilbride, and we have committed £500 million over 20 years to the Glasgow City Region deal, the first deal in Scotland and the largest Scottish Government investment commitment across the wider deals programme. And £166 million of that investment has been allocated to economic infrastructure activity located in South Lanarkshire as part of that city region deal. So in closing, I just want to extend my thanks, as others have, to the committed workforce at the FDCO in East Kilbride, and encourage the UK Government to work with them closely and the local community closely to ensure that any decisions made take full account of the views of the workforce, the local community and the impact on the local economy. 42 years of service for the people of East Kilbride must be respected. Thank you.
Thank you, Minister.